praise the Lord, everybody. Amen. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. The psalmist says so, David, let everything that has breath praise the Lord. I'm sure you are doing well right where you are at home or wherever you are connecting in your car, in your office or wherever you are. Praise God. Let us just connect this morning and have an awesome time in God's presence this morning. We want to welcome our friends, our partners, our members in house churches everywhere here in His Planting Family Church. Glory to God online. Hey, praise the Lord. And we are so privileged, amen, that we are able to even to connect via this medium of communication. Amen. The social media has made things much easier, as much as the negative side, but we know there are lots of positives, and we give God the praise for that. Amen. Glory to God. Well, if you are just joining us, welcome. Create that watch party. Amen. Remember, we're also broadcasting on our YouTube channel. So if you can't connect on Facebook or you want to go to your YouTube live, you can do that. Praise the Lord. If you have a smart TV, you can just put that up and blow it up on your screen. And you have a nice full screen and you can watch. Praise the Lord and enjoy the service. Amen. Well, God bless you. Thank you so much for joining us. But before we go any further, I want us just to agree in prayer as we begin the service and this meeting this morning. Glory to God, wherever you are. Amen. If you have your family around you, just join your hands. Let's agree in prayer. I believe God for a word for you today. Amen. Because we've got a special word from the Lord today. Amen. Let us lift our voices, everybody. Raise your voices where you are. Father, we give you the glory. We give you the praise. Thank you for this beautiful Sunday morning. The day that you have made. There's never been a day like this. Lord God, Father, we therefore thank you for it. We give you all the praise. We give you all the glory. Now we ask you, Holy Spirit, that you will minister to us, Lord, individual and collectively. We welcome you, Spirit of the living God. Have your way, O God. Minister, touch, heal, deliver, save, O God. Change, transform. Whatever you want to do, Holy Ghost, we give you leeway. We give you permission in the name of the Lord. Have preeminence through this service, O God. Let the name of the Lord be lifted up. Let every other name bow. And the name of Jesus Christ, the name that demands answers, in the name of the Lord. The Bible says there is no other name given to man through which man who could be saved but the name of Jesus Christ. So Father, we call on the name this morning and we speak healings, deliverances. Lord God, everything that is in the name will release the power of the name of Jesus Christ even this morning. So Holy Spirit, we declare, Lord God, that this zone now is demonic-free zone. There will be no demonic activity. We bind every demonic operation in every form to distract the people of God in any form of fashion. In the name of Jesus, but we decree and declare that, Lord God, you are moving in the way that only you can move, even through this internet platform. In Jesus' name, to heal, to save, to deliver, to answer, to mighty God, minister to the lives of your people. We give you all the glory and the praise. And we thank you, Lord God, that when we are all being said and done, you will receive the glory and the praise that is due to your name. We therefore welcome you, Holy Spirit. Have your way. Have your way. In Jesus' mighty name. And everybody, lift your voice and say, amen, amen, amen. Again, thank you for joining us. Amen. To those who are also connecting, welcome here. In His Planting Family Church, our online service is already on. Praise the Lord. Amen. We look forward to what the Lord is going to do today. Amen. We look forward to the speakings of God, to the Word of God. Amen. I will introduce, amen, the servant of God who will be ministering today. Glory to God, and you will be blessed. I promise you, you will be transformed. Your life will never be the same. In the name of the Lord. But well, let's get to our vision scripture declaration. Amen. This is what we believe. This is what we profess. Amen. Let's declare together. The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me because the Lord has anointed me to preach good tidings to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and the opening of the prison to those who are bound, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn in Zion, to give them beauty for ashes, the oil of joy for mourning, the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness, that they may be called trees of righteousness, the planting of the Lord, that he may be glorified. Praise God. We believe that with all our hearts. That's why we profess it every Sunday. Every Sunday we believe it, we proclaim it, and that's not just it. We are working it out as well. We are living it out. We are implementing it in the name of the Lord Jesus. Praise God. Amen. So we look forward to the manifestations of the things that God is already doing. Amen. No eye has seen, no ear has heard the things that the Lord has prepared for all of us, for those who are called according to his purposes. Glory to God. Just a few announcements. Amen. Praise the Lord. Remember, every Monday we are praying, but we're going to be, as of this coming week, we're now going to be moving from Monday to Tuesday. So we're no longer going to be connecting or praying on Mondays at 7 o'clock. Now we're just moving it to Tuesday at 7 o'clock. So if you want to know more, just let us know. You can send us a direct messaging. Amen. Then we're going to be able to send our link to our Zoom platform where we normally connect. And on Thursdays, we also have our sessions where we are teaching the word. Amen. We are on the seven mountains of influence. Praise the Lord. God is really blessing us so tremendously through the word and the teaching there. And a lot of information that we are dishing out there. So if you want to learn and grow, amen, you are most welcome. Remember, every Sunday again, we are on every other Sunday, we have our children's ministry. But this Sunday, we will not have our children ministry. We're going to move it to next Sunday. Amen. So we want to apologize for that to our little ones. Please forgive us. Amen. His kids will be on the following Sunday. God bless you as you receive this announcement. Amen. And again, we want to continue to appreciate our partners, our members, our friends who constantly sow towards God's work, who give seed, who tithe, who are offering in any way. Thank you so much. It goes a long way. And may the Lord bless you and reach you and minister to you in a special way, even as you partner with the work of God. God bless you. Praise the Lord. Well, before I go any further, I'm no longer going to be coming up except after the ministry of the word. But because today we have a special ministry of the word, glory to God. After the worship, he's going to be taking over from here. And I'll be back after the ministry of the word from none other than my father in the Lord, glory to God. And I've known him for years now. We've been, our relationship goes years. I mean, over 20 years or so now. That's how long we have known each other and we've been together. And the Lord has used him in a tremendous way in my life and my wife's life and our family at a personal level. Amen. And also at a ministerial level. And I'm just going to read his brief bio here. Called by God for this generation, Apostle Bheki V. Gamedze is one of the seasoned prophetic voices that God has raised and has used for the past 30 plus years. He has raised many sons and daughters in the Lord, praise the Lord, under his apostleship. He is a presiding apostle of Hope International Apostolic Network, which covers many men and women of God. He is a phenomenal teacher of the word and has just released a book titled The Holy Spirit Empowered Life. I encourage you to get a copy. Get in touch with New Africa Gateway Church office. They'll be able to give you more information how you can get a copy of that. I'm definitely getting a copy for myself. He is the founder and senior pastor of New Africa Gateway Church, which is based in Midrand, a phenomenal, vibrant church. He is married to Prophet Sherry L. Gamedze, and together are blessed by the Lord with 5 children. Amen. And that's the next voice you're going to hear. An awesome ministry of the word from our father in the Lord, Apostle Bheki V. Gamedze. Praise the Lord, whom we love dearly. And we thank God for your life, Apostle. And we look forward to what the Lord has prepared and whatever the Lord has laid in your heart. We know God is going to impact our lives, even as a church, and as we continue in ministry, in the work of God, and even in our own personal lives, and anything that pertains to life in general. We believe the Lord has a special word for us and for everybody out there who receive this vessel of God. And now we're going to get into the time of worship, and the next voice you'll hear is the voice of none other than Apostle Bheki Gamedze. God bless you.
Somebody say, God has spoken, and I agree. My breakthrough is here. Let's get that. Let's get that. All over the world, we want to sing this over you. Let me hear you say. Just sing it out. Yeah.
It's such a joy and such a privilege to be with you at His Planting Church. Praise the Lord. I thank God for Pastor Siabonga and Pastor Lebohang Malinga, who are the headships of this incredible ministry that is touching so many lives. And I'm just honored today to be able to come and just share some words of encouragement with you in His Planting. And all those who are watching online and listening to the Word of God today, I want you to stay tuned right now, because the Lord is going to change your life today. Well, praise the Lord. Welcome. And I want us to share the Word of God today, because I've got a word that will really encourage your life. And if you have experienced in your life that there are certain limitations that seem to surround you, invisible barriers in your life, you know, just being able to go so far but no further, God has a word for you today. What if I told you that the most powerful force in the universe is at your disposal right now? Would you believe me? I hope you will, because if you want to know what that power is, just stay tuned, because I have something to encourage you with. You should know that God has given you a power within your reach that can literally lift limitations in your life. So what am I talking about? I'm talking about words. Words, particularly spoken words. Words are the most powerful force in the universe. How do I know that? I know that because the Bible says, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth, and the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep. When this chaotic situation presented itself before God, God did not talk about the situation. God did not worry about the situation. God did not get frustrated with the situation. God spoke to the situation. He said, "Let there be light," and there was light. That's how God dealt with it, with a supernatural ability to speak creative words and see them come to pass. I want to say to you that this power is available to you and me on a continuous and on an everyday basis. Let's open our Bibles to Genesis 32, verse 24 to verse 29. The Bible says, Jacob was left alone, and a man wrestled with him there until daybreak. When the man saw that he did not prevail against Jacob, he touched the socket of his thigh, so the socket of Jacob's thigh was dislocated as he wrestled with him. Then he said, "Let me go, for the day breaks." But Jacob said, "I will not let you go unless you bless me." So he said to him, "What is your name?" And he said, "Jacob." Then the man said, "Your name will no more be called Jacob, but Israel, for you have fought with God and with men and have prevailed." Then Jacob asked him, "Tell me, I pray you, your name." But he said, "Why do you ask me my name?" Then he blessed him there. So here we have a scenario where Jacob is wrestling literally with God. God in the form of a man or an angelic being, because he wanted something from God. What is it that Jacob wanted from God? Why would he wrestle with this angel all night, all by himself, and keep on wrestling with them and say, "I'm not going to let you go until you bless me"? What made Jacob feel that he needed something more from God? Didn't God already bless him? Wasn't he already blessed by his father Isaac? Wasn't he already blessed with children? Wasn't he blessed with wives and family? Wasn't he blessed financially? What was it that was lacking in Jacob's life that would make him so desperate that he would say, "I'm not going to let you go until you bless me"? I'll tell you what it is. It's because when Jacob was looking at his experience, looking at his life, maybe the last 20 something years of his life, he saw that he was blessed, but only to a point. He was blessed, but there was a limit on his blessing. He realized when he matched what he was experiencing with what God had promised, there was a gap there. I don't know if I'm talking to you right now, because the Bible tells us the promises of God are yes and they are amen in Christ Jesus. And God has given us so many great and precious promises that by reason of these, we might have hope. And we have so many promises from God. But when we see our experience compared to the promise of God, oftentimes there is a big gap there, and we wonder why this gap is there and how we can fill it. This was Jacob's experience. When we look at the Bible, it tells us in Genesis 27 to 29 about this blessing that Isaac had released upon his son Jacob. Yes, he has stolen the blessing from Esau, his brother, and maybe that also put a limitation on the blessing, because we cannot get a good thing from God in a wrong way. But let's go a little bit further here. It says, he came near and kissed him, and he smelled the smell of his clothing and blessed him and said, see, the smell of my son is like the smell of the field which the Lord has blessed. Therefore, may God give you the dew of heaven and the fatness of the earth and plenty of grain and new wine. Let peoples serve thee and nations bow down to you. Be master over your brothers, and let your mother's sons bow down to you. Cursed be everyone who curses you, and blessed be those who bless you. Wow, what a blessing to receive from your father. This is the blessing that Jacob received from Isaac, his father, some time earlier, 20-something years ago. And this is the blessing. He says that God will give him the dew of heaven, that's rain. And then he says the fatness of the earth. Everything that comes out of the earth. That's including minerals and resources, gold and silver. And then he says plenty of grain and new wine. That is the agriculture and harvests of crops and fields and so forth. He says, let peoples serve thee. Now, this is the part where now there's a difference between the blessing and Jacob's experience of that blessing. Because up until now, Jacob had been blessed to a point, but he did not see people serving him. He was serving Laban. All of these years, he was serving Laban, but had not seen this part of the blessing come into manifestation. And the blessing said, the nation shall bow down to you. Wow, he had not seen that happen. And then he says, be master over your brothers. Now, he only had one brother, and that was Esau. That had not manifested yet. And he says, and let your mother's sons bow down to you. So here's Jacob coming to this point in his life after 20-something years of experiencing some blessings, coming to a point of saying, wait a minute, there's a limit on my blessings. I'm experiencing blessings, but I'm not experiencing them to the measure of the promise that God had given to me. Am I talking to you right now? That God has given you great promises. God has given you so many, even prophecies. But when we see our actual life being lived out, there's this gap that we just don't know how to fill. And so what is the reason for this gap? I'll tell you why. One of the reasons that we have this gap is that for most of us, these limitations are from limited words of blessings we have received or have spoken over our own lives. That's right, words spoken over our lives. Because words are powerful things that have a certain extent or reach or influence or power. They go at it to a certain point. Now, so when people speak words over us, they may be coming from a good heart, coming from a good intention, but they may be limited words. For example, when a person compares you to somebody else and says, I want you to be like so-and-so, or I like it because you are like so-and-so, they may think that they're giving you a compliment. On the one hand, they are, but on the other hand, they are putting a limitation because they are saying, this is your standard. If you reach this standard, you've made it, you have arrived. They've put a ceiling on your potential. Or maybe certain blessings are spoken by people who are critical, insecure, or judgmental. They're critical, insecure, judgmental people, and they see you based on your past instead of based on your potential. We all need people that will not just see us based on where we've been, but will have the perception to see where we are going. And some people will speak certain words over your life thinking that they're encouraging you, and on the one hand they are, but on the other hand, because of their own insecurity, because they are critical, because they might be judgmental, they put a certain limit on what they say. Why? Because they really don't want you to go very far, but they do want to say something nice. They're insecure, and insecure people are not really happy when other people around them succeed. And so they may speak those things over your life that may seem like blessings and encouragements, but there's a limit on what they say. For example, they may say, you know, you're so smart, and you know, but you know, I think you should go and get a bachelor's degree. You know, and I can just think, if you really work hard, you can get a good bachelor's degree, and you can get a good job, and you can be able to get a good salary, and it sounds very encouraging. But what if your potential is to get a PhD? What if your potential is to become a multimillionaire? That person cannot perceive that. They see your potential only so much. And they've put a blessing on you, but it's a blessing with a limit. It's a bachelor's degree blessing. And you need more than that. You need to be able to go further, and you need bigger and more powerful words spoken over your life that will open the way for you. You see, words are like bulldozers. They're like earth-moving equipment. When a road is being built, it starts off with a wilderness, with rocks and mountains and trees and all of those things and rivers. But an earth-moving equipment, an earth mover, has to go and begin to bulldoze and move out of the way these obstacles. And as it creates these and moves these obstacles, a way, a path is created. Now on that path is going to be built a road. Now that's the power of your words. When words are spoken in your life, they're like bulldozers. They uproot trees and obstacles in your way, boulders in your way, and they go before you to create a path for you to walk on. And so if the bulldozer only goes 5 kilometers ahead of you, you can walk for those 5 kilometers. You can even drive maybe those 5 kilometers, but you'll only go so far. You'll find a limitation. Many of us are experiencing life with some blessing, but there's a limitation on the blessing, because the people who have spoken over our lives have spoken those words that only take you so far and no further. Others are judging you based on your past. Oh my girl, you already have a baby out of wedlock, and you're not married yet, and look at your age. You better settle for somebody. You know, just any man that shows some interest in you, it doesn't really matter. Just be a wife to somebody and have a father for your children. And instead of encouraging you to pursue your dreams, to marry the man of your dreams, they downsize your dreams because they're actually judging you based on your past. And they're putting words of limitations that you will not go beyond a certain point. Sometimes people speak words over us and that because they feel it's their job to keep us humble. Oh, there are people like this that feel that it is their assignment to keep you humble, to keep you in your place. And they will speak things that make you think that they're complimenting you, but they're actually reminding you of your space. You know, we know what that's like in a family. Sometimes, you know, we have that experience of the pecking order, and you might not be the firstborn, you might be in the middle, you might be at the end, and sometimes your siblings have a way of reminding you of your place in the family. There are people like that who feel that it's their responsibility, and there's no such assignment, by the way, there's no such ministry. They feel it's their assignment to keep you humble, to keep you in your place. Don't pursue all these big things, just take care of your family, get a decent job, and just stay there and have a decent retirement, and so on and so forth. And yet behind it is a motivation to keep you in the pecking order. Sometimes words are spoken over us by people who are stingy with affirmations and encouragement. Some people just are very slow to encourage anybody, to lift anybody. They somehow just find it very difficult to lift somebody with a few kind words. And sometimes they'll speak those words, but they're so meager, they're so stingy with them, and they create those limitations. They'll bless you only to a certain point. And some people are just manipulative, they're possessive, and they're controlling. They just don't want you to go so far. They want you to succeed so long as they can control you. So long as they have possessive power over you, so long as they're ahead of you, and so long as they can manipulate you, they will allow you that thought to say you can succeed. And so these words are being spoken by people of our lives, time and time again. Some words are spoken by selfish people who are envious and self-centered. We need to be aware of such people. King Saul was an example of that. When he came to David, he didn't mind David being in his army. King Saul had no problem with David's success until David's success eclipsed Saul's. The people would talk about the battles and they would be giving the praises of Saul to say Saul has slain his thousands. And then they would say, David has slain his tens of thousands. Now, Saul is beginning to be upset. He's envious of David's success. And he is the one that, even though he brought him into the army, is the one that tried to kill David with a javelin, because really he was self-centered, he was selfish. He did not mind David's success, so long as David never got bigger than Saul. Do you know people like that? People who don't mind your success so long as it's not greater than their success. And they will encourage you, they will speak words of blessing over your life, but only to a point, that so long as you don't go beyond them. Then, so this is how many times we have blessings, but they have limitations. Oh, we have words spoken by small-minded people who can't imagine you doing what you're doing. They just can't imagine you doing what they have never done. And so Joseph's brothers also had this problem. Joseph was the last born at the time of all his brothers, the youngest guy. And they had no problem with Joseph, even though he was dad's favorite and all of that. That wasn't their problem. Their problem began with Joseph's dreams. When Joseph began to dream that the sun, the moon, the stars bowed down to him and all of this, they said, whoa, we are not bowing down to you. Don't you remember your place? You're the last born. And so because of Joseph's dreams, the Bible says the brothers hated him. There are certain people that will love you and will support you so long as you don't become greater than themselves. And they speak words, good words many times, encouraging words, but those words have a limit. A limit that says, so long as you don't become more successful than me, so long as you don't achieve more than me, I am okay with you. Words have supernatural power. Now let's get into the Word of God about this. Proverbs chapter 18, verse 20 and 21 says, a man's stomach shall be satisfied with the fruit of his mouth, and with the increase of his lips he will be filled. That's a surprising scripture. That a man's stomach, we would think that he's satisfied by the works of his hands. And I'm sure hands are involved in it, but the Bible says more. It says his stomach will be satisfied by the fruit of his mouth. what he says about his life is going to determine whether he's going to eat or not. And with the increase of his lips, will he be filled? Wow. So the words that we speak determine, in other words, our income many times, because our income determines whether we eat or how much we eat. And then he goes on to say these very, very powerful words that you might already know. Death and life are in the power of the tongue, and those who love it will eat its fruit. So there we have it, that the words we speak are speaking of bringing death or life. And it's in your mouth. You have that power to determine whether life will happen or whether the opposite will happen in your life. Proverbs 15 verse 4 says, a wholesome tongue is a tree of life, but perverseness in it crushes the spirit. So what's a wholesome tongue? A tongue that speaks positive things, speaks healthy things, good things, blessing, favor, increase, prosperity, protection. If our tongue is speaking these things, it's a tree of life. But what is a tree of life? It's a tree that continues to bring a harvest of good things in your life. Look at Matthew chapter 17, verse 20. Jesus said to them, because of your unbelief, for truly I say unto you, if you have faith as a grain of mustard seed, you will say to this mountain, move from here to there, and it will move, and nothing will be impossible for you. You shall say to this mountain, move from here to there, and it will move. Wow. So it's based on what you say? Absolutely. I didn't say that. This is what Jesus says. This is the potential that's right within your reach, right in your own mouth, to speak something and it begins to happen. And he says these very, very incredible words. He says, and nothing shall be impossible for you. In other words, you can lift the limitations of your life based on what you say. Now, let me say this before we go further. What we say is determined by something else. It is what we actually think and believe. What we actually think and believe is what will come out of our mouth. And so in order to change what we say, we have to change what we think. And that will change what we believe. Because at the end of the day, it's not what people really say to you or about you that matters. It's what you say to yourself. When no one else is watching, when no one else is listening, what do you say to you? Because you are the prophet of your own life. And you can set the limitations over your life or raise the bar based on what you say to yourself. And that is determined by what you're thinking. And so the Bible tells us that we must be renewed in the spirit of our mind. So now we get to the root issue is, what are you thinking? How far do your thinks go? Your thinks go. Yes, your thinking goes. And that was something that when I grew up, this is what my little siblings used to say. My thinks. I've got thinks in my head. We all have thinks. We all have thoughts in our minds. And the question is, how far do those thoughts go? Do you remember the time when God, the Bible says that Abraham was and Lot went two different ways. And then God says to Abraham, look to the north, the south, and the east, and the west. As far as your eyes can see, I have given it to you. As far as your eyes can see. We're talking about thinking now, that we have to lift the level of our thinking to see further than we have seen before. Now that's an effort to begin to renew our minds with the Word of God and to begin to agree with what God says. For example, if the Bible says, my God shall supply all my need according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus, my mind has to be able to accept that there's nothing excluded from that. All my need according to his riches in glory. And renew my mind with that. When the Bible says, by his stripes I was healed, I must renew my mind with that and see myself healed, see myself healthy, glory to God. And this is the exercise, this is the work involved in order for me to speak on a different level. I must think on a different level. Many times our level of thinking is really determined by the thinking of the people around us. Our upbringing determines our level of thinking. And so what becomes very important here, therefore, is your associations, your exposure. What level of thinking do the people that are closest to you have? Because you are going to probably be on the same level, maybe a little higher, maybe a little lower, but you're going to settle at the level of the thinking of the people that you allow yourself to spend time with. And so it becomes important that you expose yourself to people that are thinking on another level. That you begin to expose yourself to people that will challenge your thinking and begin to think at a level that will say to you, I need to stretch to that. And as you get used to stretching to that, that becomes your normal. And then your speaking begins to line up with that. Let me give you a very simple example. You know, at a certain point in your life, based on your upbringing, maybe if you grew up in a poor background, let's talk about a home. Maybe your aspiration was to have a lovely 3-bedroom home in the suburbs. That was your dream. But you find that as you grow in life, you find that there are certain people thinking on a higher level. And so you can now upgrade your thinking and say, well, why should I settle for a 3-bedroom home when I can have even something bigger? You see, that comes from exposure. That comes from you seeing a beautiful home and you say, wow, that's what I really would like. That's my dream. That's my new dream. Don't hold on to a dream that has expired. Don't hold on to a dream that has lost its fervor, whose time is spent. Upgrade your dream to something bigger and stretch your mind for greater and higher heights. Glory to God. This is how we lift the level of our thinking. We lift the level of our thinking by the Word of God and align the Word to renew our minds, and by our association and exposure. Who we talk to, who we relate to, who we listen to will determine your level of thinking, and that will determine your level of speaking. Try to keep away from people that are always talking your life down and looking down on you, speaking down on you, speaking down on themselves. Minimize your time with those people and maximize the time of the people that speak powerful, positive, great things in your life and in their own lives. Let's look at another scripture. Mark chapter 11, verse 22 and 23. Jesus answered them, have faith in God. For truly I say to you, whoever says to this mountain, be removed and be thrown into the sea, and does not doubt in his heart, but believes that what he says will come to pass, he will have whatever he says. Oh my goodness, this is challenging. What? I'm going to have whatever I say? Yes, but this is a continuous thing. It's not just saying it once. It's something you keep on saying. It's something you keep on believing. It's something you keep on declaring in your life. Even when things look negative, you keep on declaring it, that my God shall supply all of my need according to his riches in glory of Christ, in Christ Jesus. Even though it doesn't look like, you know, your financial situation is positive. I'm healed by the stripes of Jesus. I have been healed. By his stripes, I am healed in Jesus' name. You keep on declaring it. Jesus wasn't just saying, just speak casually and move on. He had the faith and the power to speak casually and move on. But you and I, we've got to build up to that. And we have to keep on speaking. He says, whatever you say, you will have. Wow. So this is not something determined by God per se. This is not something determined by you. That you are that substation determining how much power is coming from that power station to your house. The power station is pumping out megawatts, kilowatts of power, but your mind and your words are determining how much of that power is arriving at your doorstep. Now look at Hebrews chapter 11, verse 3. By faith we understand that the universe was framed by the word of God, so that things which are seen were not made out of things which are visible. Wow, that's a big scripture. That the universe was framed by words. Wow. So everything that we call reality, seen, unseen, visible, invisible, etc., things you can hear, things you can't hear, things you can feel, things you can't feel, everything is framed within a framework called the Word of God. So there's nothing in reality that hasn't been underpinned by words. First of all, the words of God, but then also the words of people. So our reality is really just a result many times of words that have been spoken, and of course actions that back up those words also. Job chapter 22 verse 28 says, "You will also declare a thing, and it will be established unto you, and light will shine upon your ways." You will declare a thing. Can you see where this power is? This power is not in somebody else's hands. This power is not even in the hands of your pastor. This power is not even, you know what I'm saying? God is saying, I've given you this power. It's in your hands. You shall declare a thing, and it will be established for you. Maybe not for somebody else, but for you. So the invisible universe itself is made out of and sustained by God's invisible creative words. Look at Hebrews chapter 1 verse 3. It says, "He is the brightness of his glory and the express image of himself, and upholds all things by the word of his power." Wow. He upholds all things by the word of his power. So behind everything we call reality is the word that comes from the power of God. So this is the secret. This is the key. The whole universe comes out of words. All of reality comes out of words. The invisible produces the visible, not the other way around. And words produce things. And we've seen it in the Word of God, and we've seen it throughout history, and it will happen for you if you use this power in a correct way. Because what is a blessing after all? A blessing is empowering words spoken to benefit totally and abundantly. That's a blessing. It's words. Comes from the Hebrew word barak, which means to benefit totally and abundantly. So Jacob not only needed superior words to be spoken over him, the Bible says so, that God blessed him there after he had wrestled with God, but God went further than that, because God was saying there is a certain thing that I need to change that is limiting you, and that is your name. Your name is Jacob. Jacob means usurper, it means a crook, it means a conniver, it means a shyster, it means a con artist. And people have been speaking this word over you since your birth. No wonder you have limitations. No wonder your blessings can only go so far, because even your name is a limitation. So what did God do? God says, I'm changing your name to Israel, which means a soldier with God. You've prevailed with God and with man, and I'm lifting the limitations off of your life. You are now Israel. So hear me saying now, you might not be cursed. You might not be cursed, but you could be living under a limited blessing. And sometimes when we are living under a limited blessing, we think we are cursed. We are not cursed. The Bible says you are blessed with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus. And sometimes we do have to break curses. But in this particular case, many times we are living under a limited blessing because of the word that people have spoken or are speaking over our lives. And even more so, the words that we are speaking over our lives. I have a few questions for you before we close. Did your natural parents ever really bless you? Especially your father, if you have a father, and if you didn't have a father, maybe a man of God, an uncle, a godly man, a godly woman. Did you have a blessing released upon you? Because without that blessing, it's like a person trying to create a highway with a spade, with a shovel, with a pick. You cannot build a road with that. You're going to struggle. Because a blessing, remember, is that bulldozer that opens the way for you to make things easier for you. Does your name or nickname limit your blessing? If so, I suggest you stop using it. I suggest that you move away from the use of that nickname if it is putting a limitation on your life. Did a man of God bless you when you were dedicated to the Lord? Oh, this is bigger than some people think. Jesus took the children in his arms and he blessed them. Why? Because you're speaking these empowering words that would open a pathway for their purpose to be fulfilled and remove boulders and hindrances on their way as they walk through life. You need a blessing over your life. Well, as a husband or a wife, when last did you really bless your spouse or your children? You can remove limitations by decreeing superior blessings over your life, aligning them with the Word of God, and watch God take you to another level. God bless you.
Wow. Praise the Lord. What an awesome word from the Lord. Glory to God. Thank you so much, Apostle. We are so edified. What an impactful word, direct from the heart and from the throne of God. We are so changed and transformed. Amen. I believe that whatever that God has spoken today, you gotta just suck everything. Just hang on the word. It does not matter where you're at, what has been happening. As you heard the word of the Lord, glory to God, just act on it. Just go for it. Do as the Lord has instructed. Every instruction, every encouragement, every directive. Amen. Implement it. Don't wait and procrastinate. Just act on it. I believe from now going forward, your life and my life is not the same as a church, as a ministry, in our businesses, in our family life, every area of our lives. Things have shifted. Things have changed. We have broken through. Hallelujah. And we will continue to break forth, breaking through. Glory to God. Amen. It's our time to break forth. No limitation, no hindrances, no holdbacks anymore. Thank you so much, Apostle, for that direct word. We really appreciate God and thank God for you, for your life. Amen. And we pray more and more grace and anointing upon your life, the Lord, to continue to enlarge and increase you, your ministry, your family, and everything that pertains to your life. We appreciate you. And also, Prophet, whom we love dearly. Thank you so much, Prophet of God. Amen. For allowing Apostle to just share with us this powerful word and to be available to minister so powerfully to the people of God. Well, with those few words, thank you so much. And if you want to sow the seed after this great ministry as well, and for the work of the Lord, amen, the details are right at the end of this broadcast. Until next time, remember, Jesus Christ is Lord. We love you. Amen.